Good afternoon, and this is Ignacio Goiso. I am the founder of Open Filing Association, and with me is Javier Mora. Javier is a senior expert working with XBRL Spain and a number of developments in the XBRL community. So, first of all, let me show our gratitude to University of Comillas for kindly hosting this webinar. The topic of today is about the really easy converter from Excel to inline XBRL. It's called RECEiX, and we will use the next 60 minutes, more or less, to explain what are the main topics and the main issues for this open source development. Where is the problem? As you can see in the top left corner, we have an Excel spreadsheet. So, a structure of Excel. Why Excel? Because the accountants worldwide use Excel. So, it's the typical tool for everybody. And when you can see the Excel, you see two tags, property and plant, and two figures, 2250 and 3375. Well, the presentation is a flat table that you can automatically translate to HTML. In the HTML, you see that this is a table. It's between brackets, table, and you have two rows that are the things that go between tier, and in each row you have two columns that are between TD. So you can see that property is translated for something between TDs, like a cell, 2250, the same, and it's a direct translation. If you open this HTML code in a browser like Mozilla or Chrome or Explorer or whatever, you can see something very, very similar to property 2250, plant 3325. And for a human, is more than enough. Why? Because the humans have the capacity to recreate the context. You see that property is a tag, is an account, and 22.50 is the value for this account. And very likely in other place of the table, you can see the entity, the period, and so on. What happened with the extract, transfer, and load process, ETL? So, fortunately, until now, the computers are unable to deduct the context, only in Matrix, Terminator, and this kind of intelligence, artificial intelligence fields, the computers are able to accurately know where is the context. So, in practical terms, in reporting, the idea is to put the figure with the full meta information for understand what is the context, what is the meaning of this figure. In this case, the figure is transformed in 22.5 million because the figure is in millions, and for humans, you can see, okay, all the figures are in millions, no problem, you make an automatic translation, but for computers, you must be more explicit. The property is not enough. Property in this case is property according to International Financial Reporting Standard. Context, you can see the CTX1 is the reference for something in which is declared the entity, the period, and this kind of information. UniRef is what is the currency, in this case is euro, and decimals are the precision until which decimal this figure is accurate, and basically these decimals minus six is please ignore for calculation the last six figures because it's not evident that are accurate. So for calculation, taking consideration only the figures prior the last six. In the second line, plant, the same. It's planned, but it's not planned according to the IFRS. It's planned according to the extension that the issuer has prepared because it's a specific definition of plant for this issuer. So, what is the problem for XBRL? It's wonderful for computers, but it's not so easy for humans because read this kind of information is complex. Well, there are several solutions. One solution is to use a specialized XBRL software, but this XBRL software is not off the shelf. It's not very common, and you need to implement something specific to provide presentation for XBRL. Even XBRL have the presentation link base, it's a presentation layer, the table in base, that is another presentation artifact, but all of them requires proprietary software. Well, why not to use a standard browser for represent XBRL? This was the original idea of Microsoft, but Microsoft discovered that XBRL is a toy for regulators with not enough business penetration to rent to monetize to make the to obtain benefit for the development. Regulators has developed the SDMX that is equivalent for XBRL but for statistics for time series, and the regulators created a consortium of regulators, international, more than regulator statisticians, like Eurostat, Bank for International Settlements, International Monetary Fund, and so on, and develop the software. This is another solution, but in case of XBRL, never happened. Other solution, data single statistic entity develop the software, like maybe Eurostat. Eurostat developed something in open source for XBRL years ago, but was not enough. Eurostat alone lacks of critical mass. Or the XBRL workshop on CNN that Javier and me were involved also lacks of critical mass, even to consider the possibility of doing that. So this was the situation for years, and we have two parallel worlds. The work for humans and the work for computers until basically Philip Halling and from Oxford University and his team developed inline XBRL. Inline XBRL is like the English curry. It's a mix of several things. In this case, Halling's team mix both HTML and XBRL, using a property of both HTML and XBRL. Both languages are derivatives of XML, that is like the English and Spanish, that both languages are derivatives of Indo-European languages. So XBRL and HTML are derivatives of XML from the same family, and share a property. When a XML structure is not programmed in a particular XML program, then this program ignores this structure. In this case, when a HTML computer see the report, simply ignore the XBRL part. In this case, you can see that at the end is exactly the same presentation than for a pure HTML table. Below is exactly the same file, but in this occasion, the XBRL extractor for ETL simply ignore the HTML presentation and only maintain the XBRL part. Obviously, a XBRL part adapted for this purpose. Advantage. So the same file can be used both for browsers for humans and for extractors for computers. The target translation is not more complex, it's a double use, but nothing is for free. The programs generating inline XBRL are obviously more complex than the programs generating XBRL along that are in turn complex enough. But don't panic. We have developed an open source approach to create the translation. This open source, let me an example. This example is a fragment of the a financial statement used by the committee of central balance sheet offices in Europe that use their own accounting plan that is a mix of IFRS plus specific extensions. How this program works? The idea is obviously translate from Excel to HTML for a browser is automatic. The only point is to add, to embed each figure related with a tag with the XBRL information. Then we develop an auxiliary sheet, the data sheet, with all the XBRL information required for wrapping each part, each value in the spreadsheet. In this case, you can see in the sheet assessed H10, 9598011. In the sheet data, you have the Q name, what is the name for this FAT, in this case, IFRS full non-current assessed, the period, the unit, and at the end, all the information required. So the program with the presentation in in the Excel, plus this additional information in the datasheet, is able to create the inline XBRL file. Basically, this is the concept. Later on, my colleague Javier will make a demonstration, but this is the concept. An auxiliary sheet with the information missing to wrap each FAT with the XBRL required meta information. Obviously, but the problem is even more complex because we can see here property plan equipment that is IFRS, land and buildings that is IFRS, but plan and equipment is a specific account for the central balance sheet offices. And remind property plan equipment is also a specific definition. Why? This is an accounting problem, it's not an IT problem. The experts, the accounting experts in the CBSO decided that for them, they need a specific definition of plan and equipment. It's exactly the same problem that with a company reporting in IFRS, that in IFRS, by nature, the companies have the possibility to extend, to create their own specific accounts, their own specific tags in our jargon. So you can see here that property plan equipment have four divisions, two of them from directly obtained from IFRS, another two defined for this particular financial statement. So we need a dictionary. We need a dictionary in this case to describe that these four tags, lands and buildings, plan and equipment, remaining property plan and equipment, and construction in progress, with these particular two names. A two name is the computer name of a label. So this, for the computers, plan and equipment is not a proper kind of expression, it's good for humans, but the computers prefer this particular notation. But in the end, it's exactly the same. So we define that plan and equipment, according to the central balance sheet offices, is a value that is exists in a point of time, not in a, during a period, in a point of time, is in the debit of the balance, is a monetary tag, and the sum of these four must be the same than the declaration of property, plan, and equipment. Using these four values, these four facts, the sum must be this. And in turn, property, plan, and equipment is part of non-current assets, and non-current assets is part of assets. This is a structure of a financial statement. In computing terms, it's called a tree, but basically is the same, but each profession use their own jargon. In computing, this is a tree. In for accountants, this is the financial statement for a company. So you can know that with two auxiliary sheets, one for data that is used for describe, for in brief, what is the account, the tag for each value, for each fact. Another to describe what is the exactly the number of accounts that we are using. You have all the meaning, all the concepts needed for create the technical inline XBRL instance document plus the taxonomy. So you can follow all of that in openfiling.info at inline XBRL, and let me pass the control to my colleague Javier for a demo. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Ignacio. So let me download directly from here, from openfile.info/iXBRL. So we are right here. We have two different versions of this RECEiX. One without any kind of data, that is this first one that we have here. And the second one with some data, dummy data, that is kind of useful, and we are going to use it right now. So let's click here in order to download the RECEiX. You can save it wherever you want. Let's save it in this case on the desktop. We are talking about quite a small in size tool, so the download is going to be very quickly. Let's open it. The most important thing here in the beginning is to enable macros, because obviously all of this development has been with Visual Basic for application. So what we need is to enable the macros. And right here we can see some sheets. The first one is the content, where we have the main button in order to let me click here. In order to execute the macro we have developed. Then we have other sheets, this with general characteristic of the company, which is the reporting, and of course the financial statement with assets, liabilities, equities. And then we have some extra data from, in this case, for dimensions, if we want to declare any dimensions, if we want to include some footnotes. Also, we have here some hidden footnotes. And finally, we have here the two last sheets that Ignacio was explaining before, one with the dictionary or the taxonomy, the extended taxonomy in this case, and the other one with the data in order to link all the dictionary concepts with their value. To generate the inline XBRL document plus the extended taxonomy is extremely easy. You just need to click here on the button and the macro is going to do everything for you. It takes about 3 or 4 seconds to generate the inline XBRL document and also the extended taxonomies on the folders that you can see here on the screen. Let's go there and let's open it. Okay, let's make it a little bigger. Here we are. Okay. So what we are going to find inside of this new folder that the tool has created, we are going to find four different items. The main item is going to be this inline XBRL document with an extension .html according to the recommendations of XBRL International. We are going to have here also the XBRL, the plain XBRL document. This is something that we can set up on the RECEiX in order to get only one or both of the files. Then we have two different folders, one with meta information. With this meta information inside, we are going to have the files that are needed in order to have the taxonomy package. Okay, all these files inside has the recommendation of XBRL International on how taxonomy packets must be defined. In this case, you are going to see here several metadata of the taxonomy and also the physical location of our taxonomy and also the extending taxonomy. This extended taxonomy is going to be based on IFRS Foundation Taxonomy. In this case, it's 2016, but can be whatever other version of IFRS taxonomy that you decide. The other file is also information for the taxonomy package, in this case, the catalog, when it's going to give the software that it's reading this taxonomy package, the location of, in this case, taxonomy must be uploaded in openfiling.info website. So in this case, we have some kind of redirection of mapping of where this openfiling.info website it is. In our case, it's right here inside of the folder that the tool has created. If we click here, we are going to see some path to the taxonomy that it has been generated some minutes ago with the schema file and all the link bases of the taxonomy. Well, as Ignacio was commenting before, XBRL has been designed in order to be used for both humans and XBRL processors. So in this case, this .html file can be open for humans with whatever web browser you want. In this case, is Google Chrome, but can be another one. Let's just double click and see how we have here an exact representation of the Excel document with this general characteristics data. And let's go to the financial statements here. We have the assets of the company. As you can see, it's an exact representation of how we are watching the Excel, but in this case with HTML representation. We have here on the top right corner some interesting plugin developed by XBRL International. In order we can identify very quickly which are the inline XBRL tags. In our case, it's quite easy because for every cell that we have on the last two columns, we are going to see the information. But if you see some other examples of inline XBRL documents from Securities Exchange Commission of USA or other regulators, you must understand that it's not easy sometimes to identify which is the inline XBRL tax. In this case, it's quite easy. Let's just click here on inline and let's say that please highlight every single tag of inline XBRL. So in our case, we are going to see, let's try to do this smaller, we can't. Right here, we can see, for example, the name of the entity, that it's this one, it's blue, the noob. If we click here on the right part of the screen, we are going to see which is the metadata of this item. We are going to see the queue name, we are going to see the value, the period. In case it's something that it's numeric, we are going to see the units, and also finally the entity which is reporting this information. So if we click on different ones, we are going to see how this metadata is changed and updated, okay? Okay, if we came back to the folder when we are working, we can see also the XBRL document. This XBRL document is exactly the same inline XBRL document, but without the HTML tags. So whatever software of XBRL is going to be able to open both of them, but only the inline XBRL is going to be readable by humans. We can, in fact, open both of them with some text editors. Let's do it with one quite popular editor, Notepad++. We are going to see here what Ignacio was explaining before, the examples of HTML code, plain code, as we are get used to it, and also some inline, some XBRL information. In this case, we have seen here some context information that it's only readable by XBRL processors, and let's go to one of the figures. This is some images that are code in base 64. Let's go down and let's try to find some numbers of the assets, for example. Here, for example, we have some information that we can see here, that it's pure HTML. And then right here, when the font color becomes black, it's because this information is readable only for XBRL processors. In this case, we have here the name, the queue name, of the concept of the item, which is the concept, the ID, the language, if it's capable or not. And we have here what is the content of this item. So with whatever text editor.
Find more property planning requirements.
that's enough. As you can see here, our offering property plan appointment. With two figures, 638 for 1 year. That is the context 3, and the context 4 is a third year. We go back 63, 61, if we go back to the Excel, this is 63 and 61. You can see here, this is the current period, starting 63, the previous period, starting in 61, related to property plan and equipment. So, as you can see, basically at the end, this is a translation from one format to other format. And obviously, the information inside the report is the same, the only change the format. As you can see, landlord buildings, plan and appointment, see the difference, this is IFRS, this is the central balance sheet offices, plan and appointment, remaining property, and one figure, and the rest, construction in progress. So as you can see, the information that is in the Excel is the same information that you can see in the HTML and the same information that you can see inside the report. A ver.
Yes, just finalizing this demonstration, just to remind you that whatever well-known XBRL tools are going to be able to open not only the XBRL files, also the inline XBRL files. So with whatever tool that is certificate, you can come here, you can open this HTML file, you can edit it, you can do whatever you want, and of course you can validate it, okay? In Open Filing, we have developed several tools, not only this one. In fact, we have developed some tools that convert from inline XBRL to plain XBRL and some others, viewers, etc., in order to work with this inline XBRL format that is going to be mandatory for ESMA in 2020. So in openfiling.info website, you are going to find a lot of different tools for working with inline XBRL, not only this converter, a lot of them, okay? You are going to find, this is the extractor that we were talking about, and you are going to see also a lot of different developments around like European single electronic format rule. So that's all from my part. Ignacio, if you want to add something else.
Yes, the idea of all of that is to reduce the regulatory burden. Why we developed that? Because this is the handbook. And the last version is from 1 week ago, more or less. You see, 22 of October, didn't check. 22 of October is Monday. So this edited Monday morning at the end of the week. And we are working in all of that because we, Javier and me and other colleagues, we found this problem in Latin America because Latin America is below the radar for a number of software providers. And the Spanish government was in an international collaboration with the governments in Latin America. Javier and me was part of this cooperation. And they request help in using XBRL. And in 2011, we started to develop this kind of tools. with the RECEiX. This is probably your first tool that I can't remember what is the original version, but it's probably from 2011. And the idea of all of that is simplify or reduce the need for working with XBRL. Yes, it's December 2011. And from now on, we have developed version and versions of that. This is in production in some Latin American countries. For instance, the first one was Superintendencia Security Supervision of Peru. That is using, this is the inline, the RECEiX. This is our program that is in use in production from 2000, well, I can't remember, at least from 2000, this is probably the first version from 2012 or more or less, and this is the current version. Incidentally, even this is open source, we are not involved in this in this production system because a company simply take the Excel spreadsheet is unprotected. You can see the handbook and all the information that you require, and simply was put in production in Peru. After Peru was used in other countries, and for this occasion our exercise is help to the implementation of inline XBRL in Europe. You can see also this handbook that I commented. In this handbook you can see all the instructions, the how to prepare this program RECEiX, basically more detailed explanation that I commented here that we have also to correct because I discovered there are some typos. For instance, these two tags are just in the opposite sense, but anyway, no problem. And you can see here how to work with this program and so on. And the idea in open filing is basically about us is create a community of people interested in working in this kind of areas. Basically, it was created in the project for developing XBRL for the banking supervision in Europe, and this association was created in September. First General Assembly was in September 2011, and the original assembly, founding assembly, was in March in 2011 in London. So this is a European approach, and well, as we have no expenses, we don't need membership fees or any other point. So as conclusion, it's simply download, test, check, work, and if you consider that you have some contributions for the colleagues, well, we will be more than happy to publish any kind of open source development in our website in order to contribute for the basically to reduce the regulatory burden, because all of this at the end in the background are the regulators. I am working for a regulator and it's part of our work.